I'd like to call the GMAC meeting back to order and turn to Commissioner Wiesen to introduce the speakers we have here today to talk about Bitcoin and the derivatives market.
Thank you, Ted. Maybe we'll just wait a few more seconds. We got people still sitting down.
Hey, while we're waiting, I just want to say thanks to the folks who are going to be participating in the next panel. Unfortunately, I'm going to have to go in about 10 minutes, but really appreciate everyone's participation on this issue, and I look forward to hearing what I can hear today and getting informed later as to what else was said. Thanks. And thanks again, Commissioner Wiesen, for organizing this.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We have our next panel here to discuss the topic of cryptocurrency derivatives. And here to help us with that, we have Jerry Brito from the Coin Center, the newly created Coin Center, I believe. Professor Houman Shadab, I hope I'm saying that right, from the New York Law School. Tim Bayan from BitPay. And Lenny Nora from Terra Exchange. And Tom Leahy from the CFTC staff. So welcome to each of you. Thanks again for coming today. And I think we'll start with Tom, who can go through some of the new and novel issues or challenges that have been raised by the filing by Terra Exchange, as well as through discussions with other platforms who appear to be poised to also try and submit a contract for listing. So, Tom.
Thank you, Commissioner Wiesen. The agenda says I'm going to discuss the process for self-certifying Bitcoin.
Tom, can you speak up? And can I ask everyone? It may just be me that's hard of hearing, but I'd appreciate it if everyone can speak up.
It's not.
Okay. So the agenda says I'm going to be speaking about the process for self-certifying Bitcoin derivatives, and I'm going to use our experience with Terra Exchange as a case study, if you wish. So Terra Exchange had self-certified a Bitcoin non-deliverable forward contract, subsequently listed that contract for trading on the following business day in accordance with the self-certification procedures of Commission Regulation 40.2. It should be noted that any contract listed that is self-certified and listed for trading pursuant to 40.2 has not been approved by the Commission. Normally, staff conducts an in-depth review of a new contract after receiving the self-certification filing to verify compliance with the Commodity Exchange Act. However, given the limited review time for a new product certification provided by the Commodity Exchange Act, Commission staff generally encourages DCMs and CEFs to send draft filings for innovative contracts prior to self-certification. This allows staff to raise issues or express concerns, ask questions before the contract is listed for trading. Terra Exchange provided draft filings to Commission staff. With any new contract, staff assesses the contract terms and conditions to determine its compliance with Core Principle 3, that is the contract not readily susceptible to manipulation? Appendix C to Part 38 of the Commission's regulations is referenced as an acceptable practice for Core Principle 3. For cash-settled contracts, such as the Bitcoin swap, self-certified and listed by Terra Exchange, the cash settlement price should be not readily susceptible to manipulation. It should be reflective of the underlying market for that commodity. In addition, it should be a reliable indicator of the cash market price and acceptable for hedging. Staff raised questions about the Bitcoin index that Terra Exchange initially proposed to use to cash settle its contract. In this respect, there are very few prices used to calculate that index, and the calculation methodology might result in an index that is not robust. So Terra Exchange responded to staff questions by developing a proprietary index that addressed those questions. The Terra Index uses inputs from several Bitcoin exchanges, and it is calculated using a volume-weighted methodology that also trims outliers. Backtesting of the index showed that the index consistently reflected prevailing Bitcoin prices and that the index was not influenced by outlier prices. Staff also raised questions with respect to Core Principles 4 and 5, which are monitoring of trading, and the ability to obtain information, respectively. Core Principle 4 requires a CEF to be able to monitor for price abnormalities in the index and requires methodologies to resolve the threat of manipulation or distortion. Core Principle 5 requires a CEF to have the capacity to carry out international information sharing agreements as the Commission may require. Sotera Exchange provided a demonstration to Commission staff concerning how they would monitor trading activity in the Bitcoin market, and that it had contracted with a third party for regulatory services, including market surveillance. In addition, Terra Exchange entered into an information sharing agreement with each Bitcoin exchange that provides prices for the calculation of the Terra Bitcoin Index. And Terra made signing an information sharing agreement a precondition for inclusion in the Terra Index. Having largely addressed staff questions during the draft review process, Terra Exchange self-certified their Bitcoin non-deliverable forward swap contract and is currently listed for trading. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom. We're going to go a little bit outside of the order of the agenda. I think it might be more natural to have Lenny speak next just because he represents Terra Exchange, who obviously has listed and designed the contract. So, Lenny, do you want to go with your presentation?
Sure. Thank you, Commissioner. I'm Lenny Nuwara from Terra Exchange. Just want to first thank Commissioner Wiegand for his opportunity to speak. It's been a number of months that we've been working with the staff here, as Tom just spoke about. We originally started this back in March, and it's been a great process that involves a lot of people, and we'd like to recognize the staff for the amount of time that they gave us in working through this. So today,
a little closer to the mic, please.
Sure. Today we're going to speak about the demand for this instrument, why we created it, the process to self-certify. I'll just touch on briefly because Tom Leahy just did a great job at that. We'll talk about how the contract actually operates and then how it's traded on Terra Exchange. So we can just go those four things and then we can get off to the other speakers. So we have some slides that they might want to turn on. Look at that. Thank you in the back room. So first off, the demand for the U.S. dollar Bitcoin non-deliverable forward. The Bitcoin community, which you're going to hear a little bit about from my fellow speakers here, is much larger and much broader than most people realize. There are merchants accepting Bitcoin as a method of payment. There are payment processors, one of which is here today, that has 40,000 merchants worldwide accepting payments in Bitcoin. There are miners. These are miners not with hats and picks, but nonetheless, that's the phrase in the marketplace for those that are generating the Bitcoins. There'll be a little technical conversation about how that happens. There are wallets, places to store your digital commodity. You'll hear that phrase in a little while as well from some of my colleagues. And there are investors in the Bitcoin industry itself that are investing in the infrastructure of Bitcoin technology, as well as those that are investing in the Bitcoins themselves, similar to investing in gold or palladium or silver. The point to be made here is that trading of Bitcoin on these various exchanges that Terra Exchange connects to is rather volatile. There's a vol calculation of 3.57 if you fancy that, or you can say that the trading can be 3% difference every day, 3% market change on a daily basis, sometimes more, sometimes less. Because of that, because it is being accepted widely, because it is being used by the diversity of players that I just spoke about, because it is a payment mechanism, again, that Jerry and Human will speak to, are a payment mechanism that doesn't have the same friction that, let's say, using regular banking channels or otherwise, there's a greater acceptance for electronic and e-commerce platforms. There's a great demand for some regulated type of risk transfer solution, namely swaps or other futures products or otherwise, and regulated because institutions are utilizing these products. This is not a platform or a product. Terra Exchange is not a platform or a product for the trading by retail customers. It is a institutional-level swap execution platform. Institutions are the user of the product, and institutions are looking for a way to hedge the volatility that currently exists or take a view of with regard to the direction of where Bitcoin price is going. So The process that Tom so neatly just described for us started back in March. We did provide drafts, is the phrase that Tom mentioned, and we've had numerous discussions with the staff over the ensuing months from March until this September 11th. The key features of those conversations were to make sure that Terra Exchange, the product, the underlying or otherwise, met all the core principles that a swap execution facility must satisfy, in particular the reference rate, which is the rate that Terra Bitcoin price index is not readily susceptible to manipulation, and in particular, neither is our swap market. So both need ongoing oversight and surveillance. We utilize the NFA for some of those services. We utilize the information sharing agreement that Tom mentioned with our contributing Bitcoin execution venues to provide us information. We self-certified on September 11th, which was not that long ago, and our first trades actually were yesterday. The market is going to lift off slowly, as most new markets do. We are onboarding customers and clients daily as we speak that want to start to trade in the space. The contract itself is a bilateral, non-cleared, different from this morning, so it's not not an issue of clearing for this. It's a bilateral, non-cleared trade that has credit support annex to support collateral delivery by either side to support the trade. It's non-deliverable. No Bitcoin is exchanged. This is a U.S. Cash settled forward. The forward contract is executed in a notional amount similar to as described this morning. It follows the track of what would ordinarily be a non-deliverable forward or another type of forward contract. Dollars are exchanged at contract maturity to settle the difference between the contract forwarded rate and then ultimately the settlement rate, which is determined by the Terra Bitcoin Price Index, which I described earlier, and we'll provide a little bit more detail in a minute. So it follows or tracks a traditional non-deliverable forward. Again, this one is a non-cleared instrument. The Bitcoin Price Index, the Terra Bitcoin Price Index, is something that we've spent a lot of time working with the staff here to firm up. We originally had some ideas back in March, and they were not as firm and as robust as they could have been, and so we proceeded to build our own, and we proceeded to connect to the variety of venues worldwide that are trading Bitcoin, the underlying, and we started to build a tool that would pull that data in and normalize that data to essentially neutralize anomalous data or outliers, and also to limit the influence of divergent numbers, divergent prices coming through from other Bitcoin exchanges, namely to mute the possibility that there could be manipulation in another exchange, and that manipulation essentially affecting the index, which would in turn affect the contracts on our marketplace. That took quite some time, including backtesting numerous times, in both internally and also submission of that backtesting data to the CFTC. And the staff has the full data to analyze that. The index ultimately becomes what is the fair value of Bitcoin spot price without having specific reliance on one exchange or another. It is essentially a composite, and it leads to a mark-to-market price, and it leads to the ability of the escrow agents and the custodians, as well as others, to have that number for margining and collateral purposes on the trades. And then finally, how is it traded? Because this is a bilateral contract, it's traded as a request for quote with the option for liquidity providers to provide indications of interest. So that would light up the screen. Obviously, none of you can read this from the distance that it currently is, but on the screen there'll be prices posted by liquidity providers. And when someone hits one of those prices, it essentially turns up a request for quote to the counterparty. Because there's counterparties involved, there's a risk transfer issue there. That's where the collateral comes into place. There are pre-trade credit checks, similar to what's required in the clearing space. We adopted that concept, and there are credit checks based upon the amount of deposit that the participant has for their margining account. Tenors range from 1 day all the way out to 2 years. That's no different than what's in normal NDFs. And then settlement at maturity uses the index that I just spoke about before. And then the CME is actually the SDR for the SDR reporting. So actually, the trades that happened yesterday were reported to the CME after the trades were completed, and ultimately the files were dumped over to the NFA for their constant surveillance. And so that's a quick summary of where we sit. And there's more slides by another presenter. I just don't know who's next. So thank you very much for the time, Mark.
Thanks, Lenny. Jerry?
Well, thank you, Commissioner Wiegand, for having me here today. And thank you to the members of the GMAC. My name is Jerry Brito, and I'm the executive director of Coin Center, a recently launched nonprofit research and advocacy center that's focused on the public policy issues facing digital currencies. I would like to provide some background on the technology that we're discussing, explain some of the demand for the derivative products, and answer any technical questions that you might have. So Bitcoin is frequently described as a digital currency, and you know, while that description is accurate, it can be misleading because it is at once too broad and too narrow. It's too broad because Bitcoin is a very particular kind of digital currency. It's a cryptography-based currency. Indeed, it's a first of its kind. The description is also too narrow because although currency is one aspect of the Bitcoin system, Bitcoin is more broadly an internet protocol with many applications beyond payments or money transfer. You can think of it like email or the web. It's an open network to which anyone can connect without permission from a central authority. Anyone can send a message to anyone else. And on top of it, you can freely build any number of different kinds of applications. So in that way, it's like the web, it's like email. Online virtual currencies are nothing new. They have existed for decades, from World of Warcraft gold to Facebook credits. They've been around for a long time. And neither are online payment systems new. We've had PayPal, Visa, Western Union Pay for a long time. So what is it about Bitcoin and similar cryptography-based currencies that makes them unique? Well, Bitcoin is the world's first completely decentralized digital currency. And it's the decentralized part that makes it unique. Prior to Bitcoin's invention in 2009, online currency or payment systems had to be managed by a central authority. So for example, you could have had Facebook issuing Facebook points, or you could have PayPal ensuring that transactions between customers are reconciled. They provided that central authority. However, by solving a long-standing conundrum in computer science known as double spending, Bitcoin, for the first time, makes possible transactions online that are person-to-person without the need for an intermediary between them, just like cash. Comparing Bitcoin to traditional payments and money transfer systems helps explain the distinction. So before Bitcoin, online transactions always required a trusted third-party intermediary. For example, if Alice wanted to send $100 to Bob over the internet, she would have had to rely on a third-party service like PayPal or Bank of America. Intermediaries like PayPal, essentially, they keep a ledger of account holders' balances. When Alice sends Bob $100, PayPal deducts the amount from her account and adds it to Bob's account. Without such intermediaries, digital money could be spent twice. Right? Alice could send $100 to Bob by attaching a money file to a message, but just like with email, sending an attachment does not remove it from one's computer. Right? Alice would retain a perfect copy of that money file after she had sent it. So she could have easily spent it a second time, sending it same $100 to Charlie. So Bitcoin's invention is revolutionary because for the first time, the double spending problem can be solved without the need for a third party. Bitcoin does this by distributing the necessary ledger among all the users of the system via a peer-to-peer network. Every transaction that occurs in the Bitcoin network is registered in the distributed public ledger, which is called the blockchain. New transactions are checked against the blockchain to ensure that the same Bitcoins have not been previously spent, thus eliminating this double spending problem. The global peer-to-peer network, composed of thousands of users, takes the place of the intermediary. Alice and Bob can now transact online without a third-party intermediary. And so how is this possible? Well, with Bitcoin, transactions are verified and double spending is prevented through the clever use of public key cryptography. Public key cryptography requires that each user be assigned two keys. One private key is kept secret like a password, and one public key that can be shared with the world. When Alice decides to transfer Bitcoins to Bob, she creates a message, and it's called a transaction, which contains Bob's public key and how many coins she is sending. She then signs it with her private key and broadcasts this message over the entire network. By looking at Alice's public key, anyone can verify that the transaction was indeed signed with her private key, that it is an authentic exchange, and that Bob is a new owner of the funds. The transaction, and thus the transfer of ownership of the Bitcoins, is recorded, timestamped, and displayed in one block of the blockchain. Public key cryptography ensures that all computers in the network have a constantly updated and verified record of all transactions within the Bitcoin network, which prevents double spending and fraud. out of technical necessity, transactions on the Bitcoin network are denominated, are not denominated in dollars or euros or yen as they are on PayPal, but are instead denominated in Bitcoins. This makes Bitcoin a virtual currency in addition to a decentralized ledger. The value of the currency is not derived from gold or government fiat, but from the value that people assign to it. A dollar value of a Bitcoin is determined on an open market, just as the exchange rate between two different world currencies. The total number of Bitcoins that will ever be issued, as well as the rate at which they are algorithmically released into the ecosystem, is not determined by any person, company, or central bank, but has instead been predetermined at the time the protocol was established. To date, Bitcoins have represented money at a floating exchange rate, and the Bitcoin network has been employed as a fast and inexpensive means of money transfer or payments. But there's no reason why particular Bitcoins could not represent something besides money. If we conceive of Bitcoin simply as tokens, then other applications become apparent. For example, we could agree that a particular Bitcoin, or indeed an infinitesimally small fraction of a Bitcoin, so as to allow for many tokens, we could all agree that a particular Bitcoin represents a house, a car, a share of stock, a futures contract, or an ounce of gold. Conceived of in this way, the Bitcoin blockchain then becomes more than just a payment system. It can be a completely decentralized and perfectly reconciled property registry. Bitcoin is therefore an open platform for innovation, just like the internet itself. In fact, Bitcoin looks today very much like the internet did in 1995. Some dismissed the internet then as a curiosity, but many could see that such an open platform for innovation would allow for world-changing applications to be built on top of it. Few in 1995 could have foreseen Facebook or Skype or Netflix, but they could see that all the building blocks were there for some amazing innovations. Bitcoin is like that today. We can't conceive yet what will be the killer applications, but it's pretty obvious that they will come. Bitcoin faces some challenges, however, and chief among them is regulatory uncertainty. If we think back again to the early internet, it was not until the government made it clear that it would pursue a light-touch regulatory approach that internet innovation really took off. Bitcoin today is in need of similar commitment from government. In the case of financial regulation specifically, Bitcoin would benefit from the development of hedging instruments. As I explained earlier, Bitcoin's value is determined on open market. That market is still developing, and it's not very liquid, and as a result, it has been historically volatile. Merchants, merchant processing services, exchanges, and many other businesses and institutions who want to build on top of the Bitcoin platform are in search of good hedging instruments. Additionally, as Bitcoin matures, its root technology, a cryptographically verifiable distributed ledger system, could be employed as a clearing mechanism in financial markets and other applications. While unprecedented, such a use of the technology could lead to important new efficiencies and innovations. As regulators begin to consider these developments, they should do so with an open mind, and avoid undue restrictions that could have unintended consequences, including limiting innovation. So thank you for your time, and I look forward to your questions.
Thank you, Jerry. Human?
Okay, thank you so much for having me here, Commissioner Weijin. It's really a pleasure and honor to be with all the panelists and the guests in this room, and thanks to the GMAC for organizing this hearing as well. So my name is Human Shadab. I'm a professor of law at New York Law School. My research happens to focus primarily on derivatives and, more recently, cryptocurrencies such as Bitcoin, so it's sort of serendipitous to be here today. I was asked to speak about the regulatory challenges from the CFTC's perspective facing Bitcoin. Basically, I see them as three. One, sort of what is Bitcoin from your the Commission's perspective? What's the nature of it? Second of all, how do we apply the traditional distinction between futures and forwards to Bitcoin derivatives in cases where it could be ambiguous? And finally, how do we regulate not derivatives that reference Bitcoin, but derivatives that are executed and cleared and traded and settled and so forth through the blockchain, through the Bitcoin network or protocol? So the first point I want to make is that Bitcoin is best understood not actually as a digital currency, but as a digital commodity. Okay, certainly the primary application or use right now of Bitcoins, perhaps besides investment or speculative purposes of owning it itself, are for payments, and there are a growing number of merchants that accept Bitcoin, and that certainly is an important aspect of what it's used for. But Bitcoin fundamentally, as Jerry Brito just noted, is a method of transmitting messages over a blockchain, what's also called a distributed ledger network. And because of that, many software developers right now are currently developing applications that go beyond payments, including things that are called sort of smart contracts, which essentially allow two parties to trade in an automated fashion, and which is also decentralized, secure, and sort of basically publicly verifiable through the blockchain. So because of all that, I think that it's best to view Bitcoins as essentially an exempt commodity, more like gold and silver, and less like excluded commodities under the Commodity Exchange Act, such as currencies or other financial interests. I think to think of Bitcoin as just a currency would be to think of the internet just like a network for sending email. It's true, but it's just too narrow.
And perhaps I don't mean to throw you off, but you made that distinction between excluded versus exempt. Help us understand a little bit more why that might matter.
Yeah, I think it might matter from the perspective of regulators because, first of all, it wouldn't bring into the equation sort of regulators, including banking regulators and monetary authorities that may be more concerned about currency type issues. Second of all, for the more nitty-gritty type details with respect to the Commodity Exchange Act, being an exempt commodity pretty much means that it Bitcoin would fall and look more like a intangible a commodity that can be physically delivered, as opposed to, let's say, a currency. So we wouldn't think, when we think about regulating maybe Bitcoin swaps or Bitcoin's futures versus forwards, I think what we think about are the deliverability aspects of it, and not so much whether, for example, a Bitcoin swap falls under something that looks like the NDF classification or something that looks like the Treasury exemptions for physically delivered FX, certain FX futures and forwards. So it's subtle. At the end of the day, it might not matter too much for how the regulatory structure wraps around Bitcoin, but I think that for a bigger picture idea, it is sort of important to classify and just get the conception right about what exactly Bitcoin looks like from your commission's perspective. And so given that's the case, the sort of second challenge is how do we apply that traditional distinction between futures and forwards to this digital commodity, Bitcoin? And often we distinguish, or courts and the commission distinguishes between futures and forwards based upon whether or not they're deliverable, physically deliverable or cash settled, whether or not the contracts are standardized, whether or not the platform serves as a central counterparty, and whether or not maybe the contracts are fungible as well. That's important, of course, with respect to futures and forwards, because forwards are basically do not fall within the jurisdiction of the CFTC, certainly not like futures contracts. And if you look at some of the platforms that are currently being developed with respect to trading Bitcoin derivatives, some of them sort of fall in between. And it's hard to determine, I think, whether or not certain contracts are futures for Bitcoin or maybe forwards. And for example, so maybe one case study here is, setting jurisdictional questions aside, is the ICBIT or ICBIT platform, which calls itself a futures exchange, which says it's selling Bitcoin futures, yet nonetheless, and the contracts are relatively fungible. They're basically 1, 2, 3 month standardized futures contracts referencing Bitcoin. On the other hand, the platform doesn't serve as a central counterparty, and it entails physical delivery. So maybe that kind of contract, that kind of platform, again, setting aside jurisdictional issues, it may or may not fall under the scope of jurisdiction of the commission, and something to think a little bit more deeply about, recognizing, though, that even though Bitcoin is digital, and to that extent maybe intangible, it can still be physically delivered, just for the same reason that the commission recognizes physical delivery in a sense of other intangible commodities, such as pollution rights, for example. So that is my second general regulatory challenge. And finally, all the foregoing that I've talked about really applies to derivatives written on Bitcoin, whether it's a Bitcoin futures or Bitcoin swap or Bitcoin forward or option. But there's another type of sort of Bitcoin derivative, and that's really a smart contract, a derivative that's enabled and basically that goes through the Bitcoin blockchain system. And what's interesting about these contracts is that, like many other aspects of the financial markets, are sort of programmable ahead of time. So maybe if you had a Bitcoin, or excuse me, a blockchain futures or a smart futures contract, you could program, because futures are already sort of by definition sort of standardized, all of the terms of the agreement except for the price, so the quantity, the maturity, and so forth, and then maybe the internal processes of the software application that applies to the blockchain could help determine the price. And although many of these smart contracts platforms and applications are currently works in progress, many companies and organizations are developing the underlying code to implement these types of agreements. Two sort of aspects of these, or two or three aspects of these that programmers or developers are starting to identify as being important are, one, multi-signature authentication to sort of verify and authenticate different aspects of the agreement or different types of the performance as the contract proceeds. Escrow services as well to sort of segregate and safeguard parties' capital or other assets. And sort of an oracle, what's called an oracle, which is basically a part of the application or a separate one that sort of interacts with the outside world to essentially incorporate or provide a data feed to the agreement. So that it sort of operates properly. And certainly in the financial instrument space, we could see how interacting with the outside world, including prices and so forth, would be important to execute that. Now, certainly the derivatives markets are very already use a lot of software and they're very tech-enabled to begin with. But nonetheless, I do think that the Bitcoin blockchain could provide sort of unique functionality, unique advantages that currently are not fully being utilized or even available through traditional technological means, if that's not a bit of an oxymoron. One is maybe because the blockchain doesn't use intermediaries, or maybe fewer intermediaries at least, the transactions could be traded, cleared, and settled much quicker, and maybe at a cheaper cost as well. Furthermore, you could probably build in, let's say, the 23 core principles that futures exchanges are required to abide by into the very code itself. And if you embed those types of rules into the agreement ahead of time, one question is, well, maybe that these types of transactions should qualify for an exemption under traditional rules that would otherwise be applicable to a contract that essentially provided for, let's say, future delivery of a commodity, whether it's actually physically delivered or cash settled. Finally, another potential advantage of a Bitcoin futures, a blockchain futures, is that it could actually allow for integration with other markets better than current futures markets do, in the sense that if there is sort of one universal blockchain or blockchains that interact with each other on a global basis, it could allow for futures markets to be more integrated with, let's say, securities markets, and even for futures markets to maybe be more integrated with commercial markets. And you could imagine at some point that a physical producer of agriculture would automatically purchase, in a sense, or be entered into an order for a futures agreement if the projected price of a commodity goes below a certain point in the future. So my last sort of just conclusion here is that given that it may be possible, and certainly many of these concepts are sort of potentials and projections about what technology may look like in the future, which is always sort of inherently difficult to do. But given that it may be possible for regulatory policy objectives to be achieved through the blockchain, to be achieved through software, through code, and embedded into the contract rules themselves, the Commission may want to think about or consider exempting these types of agreements from the full scope of the regulations to sort of balance consumer protection, market stability, and systemic risk with innovation and progress. So thank you so much for hearing my remarks. I really look forward to the discussion.
Thank you, Professor. Tim?
Yes, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for inviting me. My name is Tim Byun, Chief Compliance Officer of BitPay. Thank you, Commissioner and members of GMAC, for this opportunity. I have just maybe 5 minutes of prepared comments, and also to address your two initial questions, but I would love to address any further questions that you may have. And I think based on your look with the distinguished panelists here, there's going to be quite a few questions. But let me please start off with the next slide, please. I just wanted to give you a short introduction of myself because, you know, I think I'm very fortunate to be sharing some remarks to you today. As I mentioned, I serve as the Chief Compliance Officer, but I also spent 5 years at Visa Inc. as their anti-money laundering officer and head of credit settlement risk. Publicly disclosed on their 10Q, Visa has about $50 billion of credit risk on any given day. Prior to that, I was a regulator for the Federal Reserve Bank and the FDIC for about 15 years plus. I also worked for a commercial bank in their credit corporate underwriting department. So I hope my background can shed a little more light. Specifically on the next slide, I want to get into your first question of how is the adoption of Bitcoins going in the marketplace? And we have some visibility of that because we are a merchant processor out there. In short, as on the next slide, as a merchant processor, I want to let you know that we were founded in May 2011. Bitcoins were, the white paper was conceived 2008. Bitcoins, the first version or first block of Bitcoins came out in 2009. So by that standard, we are actually a veteran out there, but we are a very small startup. We have 40,000 merchants worldwide. On the next slide, we have about $32 million of investment capital from our venture capitalists, and we have just a few of those names out there that you can see. Index Ventures from the UK, Founders Fund, led by Peter Thiel, Horizons Ventures, supported by Li Kai-shing, RRE, associated with the prior CEO of American Express and Felicis Ventures. We have about 75 employees worldwide. BitPay is headquartered in Atlanta, and we have colleagues all over the world, as you can see. On the next slide is the adoption slide. Here is a glimpse of, as up to date to August 2014, how many transactions we do per month. And as you can see, we've been hovering about 40,000, but from a year ago, it has significantly or exponentially increased. And so we see adoption from our point of view being very robust. I want to also present you this public chart from Blockchain, where they measure or provide charts on the entire Bitcoin system. And you could see that the total transactions there steadily increasing over time. This is a two-year look-back chart. So I think the adoption is great. Is it in the Main Street? No. Is it in Wall Street? It will get there, but currently, no. So it is a very experimental currently. I think you are seeing significant startup capital being invested in the marketplace. I believe year to date, 2014, there's about $300 million dedicated or invested in Bitcoin ecosystem startups such as ourselves. And so it is progressing very nicely or very robustly. Your second question asked to start, what is the possible use of derivatives or Bitcoin instruments? And I see it in kind of three categories, for Wall Street, for your market makers, or even ecosystem exchangers that need to build the infrastructure and the idea of how to use Bitcoins. And I think they will build up the ecosystem. It could also be used by in Wall Street for trading purposes as a principal or an agent. It could be used as an alternative asset class for your money managers on the buy side. Corporations such as BitPay could use it to hedge our treasury operations as we need to pay on the merchant side or settle their transactions, which we see every day. For individual or sophisticated investors, they could diversify their holdings or even speculate on Bitcoin's, the prices itself. So I'm sure especially in this conference room, you have a better perspective of what's possible on a derivative scale. And with that, I'll leave it up to open for Q&A.
Thank you very much, Tim. We are now joined by Commissioner Giancarlo. I don't know, Chris, whether you would like to make a few remarks at this point. Okay. Okay. First, I'll open up to the group. I don't know whether any of the members have questions of the panelists. We could start there. I have a couple of my own. Mike.
Yeah, I just had a question as far as, you know, in we had some pre-read that was from George Mason University, and in the reference it was all kept referring to it as a digital currency. And so I'm trying to get my head around, and it kind of made sense as I think of it as a digital currency, but then as you were discussing, looking at it as opposed to swap in changing that and the nuances around that. So I could see as a digital currency and how the valuation and using it to purchase goods, the link in there. But if you could speak a little bit more, because it wasn't clear to me, you know, as you referred to it being a digital commodity instead.
Well, so let me answer first. I'm sure Houman would address that. It's obviously a digital currency in the sense that there are things that are denominated either in Bitcoin prices or more likely it's going to be denominated in dollars, and then it's going to have a conversion and you can use it to pay. And the first most widely used application of Bitcoin is payments, and so it definitely is a digital currency. I think you can't stop at thinking of it as a digital currency. At the end of the day, it's a token. You can use this token as currency, but there's no reason why you couldn't use that token as something else. You could use it to represent any number of things. And I think what Houman was getting at, and he can confirm this or not, is that because it is digital, these tokens are digital, this currency is digital, it is programmable. So we could have a transaction. So normally, if I give you $100, I just take the $100 bill, give it to you, now you have it, now I don't. With Bitcoin, we can accomplish that for the first time online. I can now take a Bitcoin without an intermediary between us. I give it to you. Now you have it. Now I don't. But we can introduce complexity into that kind of transaction. So it's not a simple, transfer. We can do something that says, give this Bitcoin to Mike only if the price of Google is over X tomorrow. And only if that happens, does it get transferred. So that's a possibility that is available to Bitcoin.
Yeah, just to elaborate, so certainly it is a digital currency, but it's just a lot more. And there's no doubt that Bitcoin is unique. It's hard to classify whether under a particular body of regulations or just maybe even conceptually. But certainly in commercial transactions, financial transactions, I think that that like any sort of software-enabled transaction, it can be used to sort of automate a lot of the processes. But what I think the blockchain adds is that it makes the messages themselves sort of be a type of contract performance. So let's say you take a loan through the blockchain, then the borrower's funds could sort of be automatically deducted from their account, whether it's monthly or annually or quarterly or whatever it is. At the same time, if the borrower, let's say, breaches a financial or a loan covenant, the loan could be immediately accelerated, which lenders typically have the right to do. In addition, let's say the interest rate can change in sort of a performance pricing contract, again, automatically, without the parties having to engage in sort of active monitoring of contracts, legal enforcement, or sort of do any additional conduct, such as borrowers telling their lenders, hey, by the way, I just breached a loan covenant. What are we going to do about it? Now, there's a downside to that. I don't think contract automation in every case and all the way through is the best thing for markets. Certainly, software providers already scale back and pull back on automation, which is even further possible because human intervention, manual overrides are sometimes or often in certain contexts better than a completely automated sort of contracts which pre-commit parties to a range of scenarios that they may or may not know about ahead of time. But just to go back to that question, it seems like the blockchain enables much more applications or functionality than transferring payments.
Lenny.
Thank you. So, Mike, just on a more basic level, as it relates to a swap, the swap here, or the swap can be pegged to an asset. In our instance, the asset is Bitcoin. It's the Bitcoin that is, we're getting the pricing data from a variety of exchanges worldwide, and we're establishing an index value to that. And so you can do a forward contract. You're doing the swap, which in this instance is a forward, a non-deliverable forward, based off that index value of the Bitcoin. So you and I can agree today that you know Bitcoin is trading today at 375, and you want to lock in at 350 because you have a large contract and you need to buy use a lot of it. So you and I can lock in at 350, and then in a week, a month, or whatever, we look at the index and actually the price is at 320. Well, then you get the benefit of that, and I'll pay you the difference. Or if it's at 400, well, then you're ahead, and so you would just pay me back the difference. So it operates just like a regular NDF, but in this instance, the asset is that thing that we call Bitcoin. It's the underlying asset. And in our application, the 40.2, we labeled it just an asset. It's a digital asset is one way of calling it, but the point is that it's an asset that we use the index to establish what the price is. And that we put the swap structure around that, and that's okay. The very simplest
that's
way.
Helpful.
Dan.
One of the issues discussed in the paper involves the degree of anonymity available in the Bitcoin exchanges themselves and the corresponding potential for money laundering resulting from that. And I was just wondering if you could explain further the response in the paper to that concern. I wasn't sure that it was entirely satisfactory. I was just wondering what your thoughts are on that.
Sure. So on the Bitcoin blockchain, payments are pseudonymous. They are neither identified nor anonymous. So let me give you an example of that. So if you think about a cash transaction is completely anonymous, right? So you and I can meet at Union Station, and I give you $100. You give me a bicycle. We part our separate ways. I don't know your name, you don't know my name, there's no record of that transaction ever happening, the time, the place, the amount. It's completely anonymous. That's cash. Then you have a credit card transaction. That's completely identified. The credit card issuers know your name, my name, and there's a record kept of the amount and the date and the time, sometimes even the purpose of the transaction. Perfectly identified. Bitcoin transactions are in the middle, are between the two. So every Bitcoin transaction is recorded, the time, the amount, and the two Bitcoin addresses from which payment went from one address to the other. And that is recorded in the public ledger known as the blockchain. And it's public. Anybody at any moment can go online and see all transactions that are happening right now or that have ever happened. And there's a perfect record of all transactions available to you, to me, to law enforcement, to anybody. These addresses are simply essentially random strings of letters and numbers that are basically like an account number. So it says from account number XYZ123, this amount at this time to this other account number. So you have a perfect record, but it's not tied necessarily to a particular identity. Now, you have exchanges. So if I want to acquire Bitcoin, I have dollars in my bank account, I want to acquire Bitcoin so I can use something in one of BitPay's merchants. What I do is I'll go to an exchange. I happen to use something called Coinbase. It's a very popular service. Coinbase complies with FinCEN's regulations, and so they do AML and KYC, so they identify who I am. At that moment, I am tied. My identity is tied to an address. And so it's actually... There's some other folks I could refer you to in the computer sciences who are looking at how easy or difficult it is to de-anonymize Bitcoin transactions, and it turns out it's a lot easier than some folks think it is.
Sorry. Could I add a few comments to that and hopefully shed some light? Bitcoin transactions are pseudonymous, or in your words, anonymous, but it's really what you're really seeing is real-time, almost like a ticker that goes across the NYSE ticker. You see IBM getting crossed 100 shares at $104, but you don't see on the ticker who is buying or selling that. When you eventually pull that record and find the broker-dealer, you can see who the broker-dealer was. If you examine the broker-dealer, you could see who the ultimate party is. Similarly, when Jerry buys something at a merchant, BitPay as a merchant processor conducts the KYC on the merchant, our customer. So we want to know what do they sell, who owns the shop, what's their tax ID number. So we conduct the KYC on that. Coinbase is a money transmitter defined by FinCEN's virtual currency guidelines that came out in March 2013. As a money service business, Coinbase, as well as other money service businesses, the more traditional ones being Western Union, MoneyGram, must conduct KYC on their customer, which is the consumer or shopper, in this case, Jerry. So I think it's a bit of a misnomer that it's completely anonymous. But I want to make sure that the ticker going across that is on the blockchain, that is in real time, you don't know who is on the underlining, who's making that transaction, underlining it.
And one last point on that. Tom Leahy mentioned earlier that Terra has to have an information sharing agreement with every exchange that provides pricing information to us to establish the index. Every one of those exchanges in that agreement has agreed to provide us the details, and they all do AML, KYC on all of the people trading on each exchange. Exchanges that do not provide that information to us cannot feed us information. So we're not ascribing to anonymous trades that are happening out in the marketplace.
Superna?
I have just a basic question on the mining component of Bitcoin. Like, if you could just explain a little bit like what happens there, because it seemed like from the pre-reading, there's a limited number of Bitcoins there, and then over the next 120 odd years, they'll get unlocked based on computing power. For whatever transaction verification. So, I was interested to hear, is that public information? And are you taking on variability of, your Bitcoin currency being devalued or diluted unexpectedly? Because it's somewhat random, at least in the paper, that it's basically driven, it's incentive driven. So how many people are going to be, trying to unlock these Bitcoins?
That's a great question. So it's sort of there's this idea that that the processing power necessary to mine Bitcoin is ever increasing. That's not actually the case. It's variable. And I'll tell you what the variability is. The Bitcoin network essentially looks to see how many Bitcoins are being issued in a given time period. Usually it's 2 weeks. Every 2 weeks it looks, and this is, when I say it's very difficult because there is no central server. It is all of the machines collectively connected, following a protocol. They look to see how many Bitcoins have been issued. If it's more than should have been issued, the math problem that must be solved becomes harder. If less Bitcoins have been issued than should, the math problem gets easier. But what ends up happening is that, on average, a new block is mined every 10 minutes. And every 10 minutes, 25 new Bitcoins are introduced into the money supply. And that is predictable. So it is algorithmically self-regulated. You could, if you had many more miners come in to the ecosystem, maybe for a few days, you might get a bit more Bitcoins than average, but it would soon revert to 25 Bitcoins every 10 minutes. So it's self-regulating in that way. And if miners leave the space, the problem would get easier. And again, it would always revert to that predetermined algorithmic grid.
So who owns that protocol?
It's open source. So it is, nobody owns it. It's an open source protocol that anybody can use. I know. It's.
I mean, it just seems like, you know, you mentioned that, you know, there's a dependency of everyone being, all these, you know, Bitcoins being, centers being connected mm-hmm. via this protocol. So just like I was trying to understand, like, somebody could join. How is that regulated if it's all open
yes.
source and nobody owns it?
Great question.
You know, so, you kind of need some, you know, some sort of validation or verification yeah. before you can join in.
Very good question. So it is consensus based. So if I try to join the network and I set my, I rewrite, since it's open source, I can rewrite the code and I rewrite it to say, I'm going to generate a Bitcoin a minute. You know, a lot of Bitcoin, and I join the network. The first thing that, so it's a peer-to-peer network. You join first one peer next to you, one-to-one, and then you join other peers. The first peer I join is going to shake my hand, look at me, look at that I am trying to do that, and it's going to reject me. And so it's consensus-based. If you're not following the rules, the first thing that that a Bitcoin client does is look at the peer it's connecting to and see, are they following the same rules I am? If not, it's rejected. If they are following the same rules, you get to join in a peer-to-peer fashion.
Doug?
Two questions. The first is, how do you know there's no fraud or backdoors built into the initial code? And then the second is, if all the goodie is coming from the blockchain, why not just put dollars on the blockchain?
Good questions. So how do you know that there isn't some secret backdoor? You know that the way, so I presume that many of these TVs that we're using here today and this projector run on open source software. They run on Linux, probably. So how do we know that Linux doesn't have a backdoor? The answer is that all open source software, by definition, is open and public to scrutiny and review by anybody who wants to look at it. So there are a couple ways you could do this. In a completely trustless manner, what you could do is download the source code yourself, review it, and verify for yourself that there are no backdoors. Now, I'm not a computer programmer. I have to trust some of the world's foremost cryptographers who have looked at it and have given it a thumbs up. But essentially, it's open and verifiable to anybody. So that's how you can. It's actually probably, I trust it more than I would trust a proprietary software system where you have to trust the company that is issuing it, and there's no way to peek inside. Your second question is why not dollars? I would sort of turn it around and say, how would you do that with dollars? You could imagine, so you have to have a token that that can be transferred between two different parties, right? That token, we call it a Bitcoin. Because there's a limited amount of them, the value floats relative to the dollar. You could imagine the U.S. government pegging the dollar to Bitcoin. I doubt that will happen, and so that's how you would accomplish it, but there's no technical way, really, that you could technically peg it to a dollar without having some third party be the guarantor of that peg.
But I think that's an excellent question, and I think it is possible, and we have a live example of Ecuador starting to do that now. So they actually want to tie their national currency using the Bitcoin protocol and the validation system. And as you know, as you may know, the Federal Reserve is looking to modernize their financial system, ACH, Fedwire, and I think it could be very feasible. I see it as, just like Bitcoin itself, we're in the experimental stage. The Fed could do a small experiment, tie a few U.S. treasuries to the Bitcoin protocol, tie it as a U.S. treasury, and let that be exchanged and validated. Because the core of Bitcoin is really just a validation system. The real power of the Bitcoin is to say that I no longer have that one Bitcoin. I sent it to you. and now you have it. And all the miners are putting their power, and it's actually not a peer-to-peer. I think it's a competitive peer mining ecosystem. They're all trying to first calculate the winning formula or output so that they can get the 25 Bitcoin reward. So there's a lot of losing miners out there that spend a lot of expensive electricity, but they don't win that reward, and they hurry up and try and win the next reward. So, you know, and as some are unsuccessful, they're going to drop out. Some are going to be more successful because they have more computing power. Maybe they set up shop in Seattle where the electricity is cheaper. You know, it's a very open market. But I think your question is a possible future use of Bitcoins.
I think I was just asking if it seems to me like it's just a distributed ledger that disintermediates.
That's right.
So you can have a token that represents a Bitcoin, couldn't you have a token that represents a dollar on yet a separate blockchain?
And that is what Ecuador is doing. Yes.
Okay. But it's not. It sounded to me like that they were tying it to the Bitcoin. Did I mistake that?
No,
It's a separate blockchain.
Yes, it's a separate copied or mimicked Bitcoin protocol because it is a free source. It's a free open source code out there.
Yeah. Thank you,
David.
So the material that we were reading talks about the market either being unregulated or subject to existing regulation. Where do you see this between those two, and what are the differences between the American perspective and that of Europe, or are there any differences?
That's a good question. So I think there's a misconception that Bitcoin is unregulated. I think since its invention, since day one, it's been regulated because it's subject to existing money transmission regulations and other consumer protection regulations, et cetera. So it's definitely regulated in many different ways. I could go into detail about money transmission or consumer protection if you'd like me to. I won't. Vis-a-vis other countries, it varies. There's some countries that are friendlier. There's some countries that are more hostile. So take, for example, Russia seems to have a law proceeding through its process that might make digital currencies illegal. And I think that's largely because they're concerned about their capital controls. You have other countries such as, I'm blanking now, Amsterdam, or that's the city in the Netherlands. Thank you very much. That have been especially friendly. The UK recently, the Chancellor of the Exchequer announced that he wants the UK and London to be the capital of Bitcoin finance, and he wants to initiate a proceeding to figure out how to open up that regulatory space there. So there seems to be a bit of competition right now to attract that investment and attract that innovation.
I also think that from a regulatory perspective, you have to think about different U.S. or whatever country's regulators are going to view Bitcoin sort of from their own perspective, from their own wheelhouse, and they're going to look at things that they're concerned about in particular. So maybe the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau would think specifically about consumer issues. The Securities Exchange Commission will think about investment issues. So certainly from the SEC's perspective, whether you raise capital with dollars or dog biscuits or Bitcoin, you still have to abide by securities regulation. And we've seen a couple relatively prominent sort of frauds and Ponzi schemes that happen with Bitcoin. And so coming back to the sort of commission here, I think that, you know, I think that Bitcoin is regulable in a good way that can still achieve the policy objectives while fostering really important innovations in the marketplace through contract structure and market structure as well. I think on some level that regulators need to let Bitcoin developers sort of put their money or their Bitcoins where their mouth is and say, listen, if there is a system that you think that can sort of revolutionize or upend finance by making it disintermediated and decentralized and cheaper and so forth and faster, you should try it and try to see what sort of policy objectives in terms of consumer and investor protection and market protection you can achieve as well.
Just one more point on that. The question of regulate or not is usually with regard to the underlying activity. To say, do you regulate Bitcoin is like saying, do we regulate the internet? It's what you do on the internet or how you use that for some process, some procedure, some money transfer, some buying of an asset, some e-commerce or otherwise. You don't just regulate the internet. No one does. And the internet is a protocol. Most people probably don't know it, but it's TCP/IP. It's the Transport Control Protocol or Internet Protocol. It's a protocol. Nobody in the room really cares about analyzing what the protocol is or who wrote it or otherwise, but it's long existed, originally developed with government research money, and it's used reliably for a very long time. Well, Bitcoin is another protocol, and so what do you regulate? Well, you might regulate an activity utilizing the protocol called Bitcoin, and then if it's for money transfer, well, then FinCEN gets involved. It's for something else. If it's for swaps, it's regulation that the CFTC has of a swap that utilizes it as an index that has a Bitcoin asset beneath it. So you can't say regulate Bitcoin so much as you say regulate activity that touches, utilizes, or otherwise is involved in the use of that protocol.
Commissioner Giancarlo.
So from the perspective of this regulator, to what extent would markets in swaps for Bitcoin be susceptible to manipulation?
So with regard to what we've at least established in the filing that we presented to the CFTC, we built a swap. That swap relies on an index of a series of underlying markets. Those underlying markets could potentially be susceptible to manipulation. What we had to establish with the staff and ultimately in our self-certification was that the numbers that we're pulling from these various exchanges will ultimately be curated, filtered, take out anomalous behavior to prevent somebody from essentially attempting to manipulate, either attempting and essentially meeting the requirement of it's not susceptible to manipulation at two levels. First, is our market susceptible to manipulation? Every participant in our market governed by CFTC rules and Terra Exchange rules, and we have our own surveillance, and we also have the surveillance of the NFA to back us up with regard to market participants. We also surveil the underlying markets that feed the prices into the index, and as I mentioned before, we have information sharing agreements with each of those markets. Those locations that we pull data from provide us access to individual traders, if necessary, and positions that those traders may hold to determine whether there is going to be manipulation taking place. As a matter of fact, the exchanges that we connect to are proud of the fact that they are following AML and KYC and want robust marketplaces to address the very question, Commissioner, that you're asking, which is there manipulation happening? They want a sound marketplace. They're actually achieving it in their marketplaces, and then we can take that data and build the swaps off of that.
So you have these information sharing agreements between the CEF, Terra Exchange, and the cash markets that are feeding the prices.
Correct.
So, but what other surveillance type functions do you, the CEF, actually perform? So you're getting reported information, you're getting a right of access of some sort, but how otherwise are you surveilling these individual cash markets around the globe?
We surveil them by pulling those feeds in and watch the prices on the feeds. We use technology to watch the price action, and when we find anomalous behavior, it's filtered out in the index automatically, but it also prompts the phone call for us to make inquiries during the analysis period between March and when we ultimately filed. There was activity on one of the exchanges, for example, that essentially looked like someone could be doing something. It triggered flares, you know, flags on our system to advise us, hey, look out, go look at this behavior, which we did. We made the phone call, spoke to the technology personnel, and also spoke to the underlying controllers of the accounts. They said, no, this is, you know, we know these players. There's nobody moving the market in a particular way. There's no wash trades, no this, no that. So we have that information at our disposal so that we can constantly monitor.
Commissioner Giancarlo, anything else? I think that's going to bring the meeting to close. We've gone over time. Thank you again very, very much. Just one last point I'd like to make on Bitcoin. Obviously, there's relevancy here in taking up this topic today in light of Terra Exchange's filing. As you mentioned before, we expect that we're going to receive other filings from other platforms as well in the very, very near future. I was interested to hear in some of the remarks by the professor about these applications that could be made of this technology in a way that's actually useful to our space, the derivatives space.
And it just seems like, based on what I've learned, some of those applications could be so compelling that it would be a real mistake for us as a commission to not make sure we're staying on top of these developments, not because we want to do anything other than understand the developments, because it seems like this protocol, the Bitcoin protocol or something like it, is very, very likely here to stay. So the more information and education we can do on this now and try and stay somewhere in an appropriate spot on the curve, the learning curve, seems to be a very sensible thing to do. So I thank all the panelists for being here today. Very, very helpful, very useful. Tom, thank you for representing the CFTC staff. And I'll turn it back over to Ted.
No, I think we're good. I want to thank everybody for coming. I want to give a special thanks to our staff, Margie Yates, and her team for doing all this work that goes on behind the scenes. It's a big lift for us, but I appreciate everyone coming today. And as the DFO and temporary chair, I now adjourn the meeting.